Good morning and welcome to Londonderry Christian Church. We're here to love one more. We're so glad you chose to join us this morning, whether that's here in person in the building or if you're watching from home. We're so glad you come to worship our great God with us today. If this is your first time checking us out, we please encourage you to fill out our online connect card that can be found at LondonderryChristianChurch.com and click connect. That'll take you to our online connect card. For each person that fills that out, we're going to give $5 away to the Emmanuel Maria Ministry Fund, which supports the Emmanuel Maria Ministry in Romania. So fill out the connect card, we get to give some money away and also get to know you a bit better. It's a great thing for us to do, and we'd love for you to fill out that card for us. Also, I want to invite you to some things that are happening in the coming days and weeks. The first one is coming up this Wednesday night at 8 p.m. at facebook.com/LondonderryChristianChurch as we're having our Wednesday night prayer time where we're praying through the Book of Psalms. So join us at 8 o'clock at Facebook for that. Also encourage you please to register if you have not done so for our Easter services coming up in 2 weeks at 9:30 and 11 a.m. on Easter morning. So if you haven't signed up for those, please do so. Then also we need 4 more volunteers to sign up to help us out at the Sunshine Soup Kitchen on Monday, March 29th from 3 to 6 p.m. So we're going to prepare a meal and help serve it at the soup kitchen. And so if you're able to help out that day, we could use the help. So please go to LondonderryChristianChurch.com and click events, and you can register to help us out at the soup kitchen on Monday, the 29th from 3 to 6 p.m. In a few moments, we're going to sing some songs together. We're going to study God's Word together. Then we'll take some time to remember what God has done for us through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus in what we call communion. So if you're watching from home, you can go ahead and grab a piece of bread, a cracker, or a tortilla, and you can get some juice, water, or milk, and have those for later. If you're here with us in the building, hopefully you grabbed your communion cup on the table on the way in. If not, you have time to go grab one of those. Today we're continuing our series as we explore the songs of ascent found in the Book of Psalms. Our series is called Songs for the Journey, as we explore how we can be transformed in our journey following Jesus. If you would, please say the verse of the day with me. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. Psalm 127, verse 1. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you're with us on our journey following Jesus. May your word and your spirit continue to be at work in us, transforming us as we gather together around your Son. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Dave. Church, I am Jesse Todd, and I'm filling in for Mark this week, and I am joined by Matt on guitar and Doug on drums. And whether you are watching from home or here in person with us, we want to invite you to stand or remain seated, whatever you prefer, whatever is more comfortable, as we worship together and lift up praises to our God. So if you would like to stand, please feel free to right now as Doug clicks us off. Calling us here today, God, for waking us up this morning and for knowing that we have a purpose for the day. And Father, I pray that we would use every opportunity in our time together to worship you, that it's not just through singing, but it's through hearing your word, it's through diving, and it's through getting to know you a little bit more, a little bit deeper. Father, we love you so much, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Thank you, church. You can have a seat.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name's Dave. I'm the preaching pastor here at Londonderry Christian Church. And as we dive in this morning, we'll take a few moments to start by talking to our kids who are either here or watching from home. Who can tell me what this is? Right, it's a honeybee. Now, has anyone ever been stung by a bee? Yeah. When I was in grade school, our playground was pretty big at our school. And it was covered with grass, and every spring we'd get lots of dandelions. And when the grass would start growing, the first few weeks they wouldn't get out and start cutting the grass as regularly, so it would get a bit taller. And as kids, we loved to take our socks and shoes off and to go running through like the thick grass that we had, which was fine most days. But there were some days, one day in particular I remember, that wasn't so great. We took off our shoes and were running, and one of the girls in my class was running and stepped on a dandelion that had a honeybee on top of it. And she got stung by the bee in her foot. She's like, has to go inside and see the principal and the nurse because she got stung by the bee. And then we all got scared and didn't take our shoes off anymore. So we didn't want to get stung by a bee. But bees, like, they can be scary because when you step on them or if you bother them, they can sting you. But that's not really what they want to do. What bees want to do is to do their job, which is to go from flower to flower and pass pollen around. They are pollinators, and that they help flowers grow by spreading the pollen around. And then they go back to the hive, and they work hard at making honey. Have you ever watched a honeybee in your flower garden or in your yard, just kind of just going from flower to flower, just buzzing around, seeming all happy and chill, not worried about a thing, just going from flower to flower to flower. While a bee can be incredibly busy in what it's doing, its work of spreading pollen and then making honey, it seems like it has a happy attitude as it does so. And what we're called to be as people is that we can get busy sometimes, busy with school and homework, busy with our sports and our activities, busy with playing and having fun, busy with stuff at home with our families, that we can be really busy, but the Bible says that even in the midst of our activity, we need to have a good attitude. Ephesians chapter 6 says, "Work with enthusiasm, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people." That while we do all the things that we do, we need to remember that what we do, we should have a good attitude because what we do brings glory. It shares who God is if we have the right attitude. So we need to keep our attitude in what we do so we can have a happy attitude for God. Like the happy bee who buzzes from flower to flower, we want to be happy in all that we do so that we can show who God is through what we do. So thanks for listening, guys. We talk about the awesome honeybee. As we continue, the last few weeks, I've been thinking a lot more about when my boys were younger. Part of that's because in the last month, we have welcomed our baby girl, Ivy, into the world, to our family. And so as we're going through this newborn phase again, it's making me think about when the boys were little, how things were and what happened. And so as I was preparing for today's message, digging into this psalm for this week, I was thinking about when Callum was younger, there were times that we would have to take him like to the doctor to get a shot, to get vaccinated. He didn't like getting shots. He didn't like the needles. He didn't like them at all. And so we figured out that when we took him to the doctor to get a shot, we needed to have some way to distract him so that we could keep his attention somewhere else so the doctor or the nurse could do their thing, give him the shot, and it would be over and done with before he realized it. So we used a very effective, but probably not great, parenting tool known as YouTube. On YouTube, we found a channel called Super Simple Songs that had like kids' nursery rhymes and other songs that they were all made for kids, cartoons that he could watch on our phones while at the doctor until, you know, the shot was over and we could move on. On that channel, one of the songs he really, really liked was called Do You Like? And so it would say, do you like something? So it'd be like, do you like broccoli? Yes. Yes, I do. Do you like ice cream? Yes. Yes, I do. Do you like broccoli ice cream? No, I don't. Yucky. So it would take these two things that you like and then smash them together and be like, what about now? So like, do you like donuts? Yes. Do you like juice? Yes. Do you like donut juice? No. Do you like bananas? Yes. Do you like soup? Yes. Do you like banana soup? No. And then the last one they did was, do you like pizza? Yes. Do you like popcorn? You know it. Do you like pizza popcorn? Probably. Some pepperoni, some mozzarella in there. I'll try that. That sounds pretty good to me. But it takes these two things that don't go together and puts them together, and you're like, what? That doesn't work. And so today, as we dive into this psalm for this week, it's going to seem like that. The first half of the psalm makes a lot of sense. The second half makes a lot of sense. But they get smashed together, and you're like, what is going on here? What does the first half have to do with the second half? Where's the connection? It seems like the author took these two kind of random things, smashed them together, and you're like, ugh, yucky. And so we're going to dig in and see what is going on. What do these two pieces of this psalm say? How do they fit together so that we understand what God's trying to tell us? The overall theme of what we've been looking at is we began the year with a series called One Word. And the challenge was, rather than making a New Year's resolution, was for you to ask God for one word for 1 year. One word that you can focus on to help you grow throughout the year. And so my word for this year is rest. And right now my theme verse I keep going back to is Jesus says, come to me all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I think part of why God gave me the word rest is because he knows I'm going to need it. I've not had much sleep the last few weeks, and my wife has had even less sleep. So I've been trying to find moments of rest with God when I can. And the overall theme, I prayed and sought God and asked, what's his word for our church? And I feel like the word God has led me to for our church for this year is the word transform. That what we need as people is transformed hearts. What we need as a church is to be transformed and changed by God's power. And so we've been looking at, over the last few weeks, these psalms called the Songs of Ascent. And they're all about our journey following Jesus and how we're being transformed on this journey. We talked about repentance and mercy and God's protection and God being with us. And so this week we're going to look at another area of our life that God wants to bring about transformation to as we journey following Jesus. So let's dive into this psalm and watch how the psalmist takes these two parts and smashes them together, and we'll see if we can figure out what he's trying to tell us. Look at Psalm 127, starting in verse 1. It says, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat. For he grants sleep to those he loves. Children are a heritage from the Lord. Offspring are a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. So you have the first half seems to all be about human activity. It's about building, guarding, toiling. And it says that unless the Lord is in those things, they are all in vain. But then we get to the second half, which seems disconnected. It goes from work to children. It says children are a heritage from the Lord. They're a reward from God. And it seems like the author has taken these two ideas of work and kids and smashed them together and put them in one psalm. You're like, what does work have to do with children? What is he trying to tell us? Well, there's one big message I think that the psalmist is trying to teach us that connects these two things. And here's the big idea of this psalm. He's saying, labor without God is empty. Labor without God is empty. Yeah, that's pretty evident in the first half of the psalm. He says, unless the Lord builds the house, unless the Lord guards the city, you're staying up late, you're toiling, all that doesn't matter unless God's in it. It is vain, it says. And here in this psalm, this word vain is used. One of the most famous parts of the Bible where the word vain keeps popping up is in the book of Ecclesiastes. And we're supposed to think of Ecclesiastes partly because in this psalm, in verse 2, it says that that the Lord grants sleep to those he loves. And the term used that he loves there would be the word Jedidiah, which was God's name for Solomon, who wrote Ecclesiastes. So it's a little kind of signal to say, hey, pay attention. Solomon's involved here, and the word vain's involved. So we kind of think back to Ecclesiastes. If you remember the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon writes this book, and he goes through all these areas of life. He talks about education and wisdom and work and friendship and pleasure and on and on. And he says that all of those things are vanity. He says, vanity, vanity. They are a chasing after the wind. And in Ecclesiastes, the word that's used for vain is the word hevel. And hevel carries the idea or image of breath. He says that all these things that we do, our education, our work, our family, our friends, our pleasure we seek, all of that is like breath, which means it's here one moment and then gone the next. That these things are important and they matter, but they don't last. They don't leave a lasting impact or a lasting legacy. That we can be super educated, have a great job, have awesome friends and family, but when we die, Solomon says that they blow away. They're gone. That's in Ecclesiastes. So here we come to Psalm 127, where it says that all these things, unless the Lord builds the house, unless he guards the city, those things are done in vain. The word vain used here is a different Hebrew term, and that's the word shav, which means empty or nothing. In Ecclesiastes, they matter, they're important, but they don't last. Here he says, all of our labor without Yahweh is nothing. It's empty. It carries no weight. It carries no substance. He's reminding us that labor without God is empty. That's clearly seen in that first half of the psalm when he says, unless the Lord builds, it's done in vain. But the thread continues into the second half where he says, children are a heritage from the Lord. They're a blessing from God. And again, it's like, what does kids have to do with work? In our modern world, we understand the science behind reproduction. Like, so much so that I had to take a class in high school that I still have nightmares from the slides we had to see. I learned far more about human reproduction and biology and health than I ever wanted to know. And so we understand the biological processes that take place that lead to conception and a child being born. But in understanding the biology, we have the danger of losing the miracle. And the biblical worldview and the biblical authors understood this. That for them, they didn't understand all the science of exactly how things worked and happened. They knew the basics. But what they truly knew was that if you had children, that was an act of God. That in order to have kids, that required divine intervention. We see this pop up in the biblical story over and over again. You have Abraham, who wants a son. He gets so fed up waiting, he takes matters into his own hands and does the wrong thing, till finally, through a miracle, Isaac is born to a 90-year-old woman. We see this Mary being given the birth of Christ. It's a divine miracle. That the gift of life and children is a miracle of God at work. And so that labor of growing a family requires God's involvement. And so he's reminding us both in our labor as far as work activity and our labor in building a family, both require God to be at the center. They both require God's activity in order for those to have meaning and purpose. So he's reminding us that labor without God is empty. So if we recognize that labor without God is nothing, what do? So he calls us then to place God at the center. Here's what we see from Psalm 127. He says, labor with God places God's work at the center. Look at verse 1. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. And verse 3. Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. All of us labor. All of us work. Whether you're a stay-at-home mom, or you work 9 to 5, or you're retired, all of us labor. We all have some form of activity that we give ourselves to in our lives. And part of what the Bible is trying to show us is that all of our life and our work is connected. That we have the tendency in our world to try to compartmentalize things. So we have our work life, we have our family life, we have our hobby life, we have our church life, whatever it is, we have these different boxes. Or maybe we're not that compartmentalized, maybe we're just bigger. We have our sacred life, going to church, praying, reading the Bible, those kind of things. Then we have our secular life, our work, our family, our hobbies, our TV shows, our sports teams, and those two boxes, and we try to keep them separate. And yet the Bible would say that they're not separate, that all of life is sacred. So all of our activity should be informed and centered around our faith and belief in Yahweh. That all of these things go together, and so our labor in our work and our labor in our families all are centered on Yahweh and his presence. That it's a matter of perspective. How do I look at things? Do I see my work as being a part of God's work, or is my work all about me? Eugene Peterson, in A Long Obedience in the Same Direction, says, before anything else, work is an activity of God. We must comprehend the biblical record. God works. That we have this idea that our work is about us. And yet the Bible would say to us, no, that the first worker in the Bible was not a human being. It was God. In the very beginning, Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning, God worked, or God created all things. That the first act of work and the first laborer in the Bible was God himself. And so as we enter work, as God has designed us, later in Genesis 1 when he says, go out and rule over the world, fill the earth, subdue it, work, labor in creation, God's calling us then to come not do our own thing, but come participate in what he's already doing. That as we put God at the center, we're recognizing that our labor, whatever role we take, is not about us, but it's coming alongside and participating in what God is already doing. That God is the one at work, and he invites us in to his work through our work. Whatever activity or vocation that we're doing, we are participating in God's work. That we're creating, we're striving, we're shaping, we're subduing, we're forming, we are fulfilling our God-given calling to participate and partner with His work to rule and reign over all things. That as we labor with God, it places His work at the center, where it's less about us and more about discovering how what I'm doing is working with God and His work of bringing order to the world, of bringing love and hope and peace and His presence to all things. We labor with God. The next thing we see is as we labor with God, it creates space to relax. Labor with God creates space to relax. Look at verse 2. It says, "In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for He grants sleep to those He loves." And then verse 3, it says, "Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from Him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court." As we labor with God at the center, as we labor with God, therefore bringing purpose and meaning to what we do because we're participating with God's work, God then creates space for us to relax. God worked for 6 days and made all things. And then it says on the seventh day, He rested. And God then established for us this pattern of 6 days of work, a seventh day of rest. Because it is necessary for us to stop what we're doing, to stop our labor, so we can rest and relax. It says here in verse 2 that we rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for God grants sleep to those He loves. That God gives sleep as a gift to those He loves. I know that for me, I don't always accept that gift like I should. There are too many times where I will stay up too late watching one of my programs, watching Netflix or whatever, and they'll come and they'll say, "Do you want to continue watching?" Which means I've been watching too long as it is. And I'm like, "What time is it?" "It's 10 o'clock. Yeah, why not one more?" Instead of going to bed and resting, accepting the gift of sleep He offers, I try to continue in my entertainment-obsessed life. That God gives us a gift of sleep. It's a chance for our bodies to recharge, replenish, and heal itself as we rest. That sleep is needed and necessary. It's a gift of God to those He loves. He goes on and says that children are a heritage, a reward to those He loves. He says that blessed are those whose children are born in their youth. They're like a quiver of arrows, that when they contend with opponents in court, they will not be put to shame. He's talking about that as you have kids, when you grow older and they are older, you now have others who are there to come alongside you and help fight your battles with you. That you're not alone. Again, it's that idea that you can relax. It's not all on you. That we live in this work-centric culture. Anytime we meet somebody, first question they ask, "What's your name?" We say, "Hi, my name is Dave." Second question, almost always, "What do you do? What do you do for work?" That we identify, our identity is rooted in what we do, in our labor. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, how we communicate who we are. But if our life is centered on our work, we can miss out on this gift God gives of relaxing. It seems in our culture that we go to one of two extremes. On the one hand is workaholism. That I'm going to work, labor. It's all about my job, my work. I can't stop thinking about it 24/7, all the time. I'm focused on work. Or, on the other hand, because God is the one working, and he's calling me to participate in his work, that means I don't gotta work. So I can stay at home, kick my feet up. So it's either between workaholics or laziness. And yet the Bible doesn't call for either of them. Like most things in the Christian life, it's this tension in the middle where we find ourselves. Where God calls us to labor well, to work hard for what we do, but not to do so much that we're consumed by it, and not so little that we don't do anything, but to do so, but to labor in a way that is productive, so then we can take time to disengage and rest, so that we can relax. How many of us take time to productively relax? Now, there's a difference between productive relaxation and unproductive relaxation. I'm great at unproductive relaxation. I sit down in the evening, turn the TV on, turn the brain off, and just veg out for a couple hours. I can do that with the best of them. And that's okay at times. But if that's our only method of relaxation, there are better ways to relax. I've discovered that I get a lot more relaxation and benefit from hobbies that bring life, that are active, that I'm doing something, but it's doing something in a way that's building life back into me. One of those is I've figured out that I like to build things for our house. So I've built shelves and a table and other things. I want to build a bag set for our family. I like going out in my shed and playing with my power tools and trying not to cut my fingers off. Still working on that one. But I like to go do that stuff. Because in doing so, while it's engaging, I'm thinking, I'm involved, but my brain's engaged in a way where I can also think about other things productively. Like, it's amazing how while doing that, I can relax. Like, I also enjoy mowing my yard. Well, it's an activity. While I'm mowing, I can think about other stuff. And so I'm able to relax productively. That what we're called to do as well is not just unproductively relax, but find a way to relax that brings life to you. That's rest. Sabbath rest is not disengagement. It's engaging in a way that is productive and relaxing and beneficial to you. So the psalmist calls us here to labor with God and relax. And he gives three added reasons why we can relax. The first, God is with you. That you can relax because God has not left you alone. He is with you, calling you to participate in what he's already doing. The second is, God favors you. You can relax because God loves you, and actually, he really likes you. And so he wants you to take time to rest and relax. And the third is, God gives you rest. That rest is a gift from God. He wants you to take time to relax and refresh and re-engage rested. He provides it to you. So the psalm calls us here to relax and keep God's work at the center of our labor. To recognize that all that we do is to work with God in what he's already doing, and to offer or to accept the rest and to relax that he gives us. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this opportunity that we can dig into your word and discover that the labor you offer to us, the labor that we do, is to work with you. God, that what we do is not solely focused on us, but it's to come alongside what you're already doing. So God, help us to be engaged in what you're doing and to find ways and times and opportunity to rest, to allow you to renew us and refresh us and replenish us through your Spirit. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Dave, and church. Whether you stay seated or stand, I'm going to respond to what Dave has taught us today through song.
To thee, my
In Matthew chapter 11, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light." That we are invited into participating with God and His Word, and to find rest in Him, because He has completed the biggest work for us through Jesus. That through Christ's death on the cross, He has taken our burdens upon Himself so we can have rest. And so every week we have this opportunity, this moment, to slow down, to pause, and to remember what God has done for us. That God has done the greatest work for us in the cross, and He invites us into His rest. If you're watching from home, you can grab your piece of bread or cracker or tortilla. If you're here with us in the building, you can open up the top of the cup to the wafer. This wafer symbolizes for us the body of Christ that was broken for us so we could enter God's rest. Let's take it together. Same way, you can grab your juice, water, or milk if you're watching from home, or if you're here with us in the building, you can open up the foil to the juice and the cup. This juice symbolizes for us the blood of Christ that was poured out for us so we could enter God's rest. Let's take it together. Same way, each week we have an opportunity to respond to what God has done for us. That the Bible says that Jesus has taken our burdens upon Himself, and that frees us then to participate in what God is doing, to find ways to work with God so we can share His love with others. And there's a variety of ways that we can do this. We highlight every week that one of those ways is through giving. That you can give out of your time, energy, and your effort to serve and love others throughout the week. And we encourage you to give financially to help partner with us, with Londonderry Christian Church, in our mission to love one more. So we can share God's love with more people, invite them to give their burdens to Christ and to receive the rest He offers. There are a variety of ways that you can give. You can place your giving in the offering box as you leave. You can give through our church website, or you can set up online giving through your bank as well. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for what You've done for us. God, that You completed the act that was needed for us to enter rest with You, that You took our burdens, You took our sin upon Yourself on the cross, that You poured out Your blood to cover us. And so, God, we are thankful that there are not words to express the gratitude we feel for what You've done for us, that You give us life through Your death. And so, Father, help us to respond to what You've done by finding ways to work with You, to share Your love with others, that we could be a church that continues to reach out to our community to tell them by what we do and what we say of Your great love. And so, God, we pray that You would take what we give today and this week, and You would use it to help one more person discover Your amazing love and to enter the rest that You offer in Christ. God, we love You. We thank You. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. As we close, I want to say thank you again for joining us today. And a few reminders, if you'd like to connect with us, please fill out the online connect card that we found at LondonderryChristianChurch.com by clicking connect. Also, please be sure to register for one of our Easter services. And if you're able to help us on March 29th at the Sunshine Soup Kitchen, please sign up for that as well. Let's pray. Father, we thank You that You are with us on our journey. Thank You that You are inviting us into participating with You in Your work. thank you for the gift of rest. And may we continue to center our lives and our labor in you. It's in Jesus' great name that we pray. Amen. Have a great week and keep finding ways to love one more.